Very good afternoon, everyone. Hope you all are safe and well and healthy. My name is Shivani Malhotra, and I'm the co-founder and CEO of Positive Vibes Consulting. And welcome to yet another session of our Leadership Spotlight series, albeit this session is a little different. Times are tough. Today, we all are probably going through the toughest phase in our lives. We are seeing our near and dear ones suffering. Some of us have unfortunately lost people close to us to this pandemic, and some of us have ourselves battled and experienced the harsh effects of this pandemic. And all this has taken a toll on our mental health. With so much happening around, it's natural, to feel scared, depressed, sad, anxious, and stressed out. All in all, tough times. But as they say, tough times don't last, but tough people do. So in today's session, we are going to learn on how we can have a tough and a strong mental frame to go through all that is happening around us. And to do that, today I have with me one of the most renowned and experienced mental wellness expert with us. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Roma Kumar. Welcome, Dr. Roma.
Hi, Shivani. I'm happy to be here with you on Positive Vibes Consulting, and thank you for getting me here.
Thank you. The pleasure is completely ours. We are very, very grateful to you that you could take out time, especially in the current situation, which I'm sure has put a lot of pressure on your time, as there would be people seeking out help and support from you around the corner. So very grateful to you for talking to us today. For our audience, I'd just like to give a brief introduction about Dr. Roma. So Dr. Roma is a senior consultant psychologist at the Institute of Child Health. She's also the vice chairperson psychology at the Institute of Psychiatry and Behavioral Sciences at Sir Gangaram Hospital. With a career spanning over 3 decades in the field of mental wellness, Dr. Roma is also a senior consultant at Max Hospital Gurgaon, founder of Saksham Child and Adolescent Guidance Clinic, and partner and co-founder at Emotionally. Again, once again, on behalf of our audience here, very warm welcome, Dr. Roma.
Thank you.
So, with so much going around, we hear on a daily basis of someone, struggling with their life, someone close, passing away, and the general struggle that so many of us are facing. Whether it is getting access to a hospital bed or oxygen or even critical medicines. So when we have so much going around us, how do we maintain mental composure and a positive mindset? What's your advice?
I think it's the toughest question for the current times that we are in. It wasn't the same last year when we were all in a lockdown for a longer period of time. And the current pandemic has really hit us, all of us, very, very harsh. And there's too much of gloom, too much of turbulence outside. Well, I would say, yes, there is turbulence. But on the other side of the coin, you have to also see that there are so many people who have recovered, recovering back at home, recovering from the hospitals, and have been much better and are now getting much and much better. So I would only suggest that instead of focusing only on the negatives which are there, which the pandemic is showing, and which all the WhatsApp groups are talking about, and everybody is actually talking about it, also see the best part out of it, that there are so many people who have come in from the humanitarian ground side and are helping people who are unknown people also, whether it's with food, whether it's with oxygen, whether it's with anything, So let's focus on something which is happening, and it's happening in positive light. I know that in most families, there are deaths which have happened, there is losses which have happened, there are families which have gone away. Yes, that is true. There are children who are left homeless and isolated and abandoned. Yes, that's true. But let's see the humanitarian stuff there, that we are all in it together, and we can all make it go through. We are sailing in it together. There is an anchor, and let's wait. There is hope. I think what needs to be taken care of is the hope which is there. We have to ignite that hope in all of us.
Absolutely. I think that's a very positive statement that, yes, there's a lot going on around us, but there's a lot of goodness also, you know, that we are seeing around us, where people are chipping in to help strangers. You know, there are free camps, you know, free hospital beds all over. That's a different, you know, situation that, you know, some people are not able to get the bed, or, you know, they're struggling. Those are other, you know, logistical issues. But definitely, you know, I think this pandemic has also shown us the other side of humanity, where, you know, you are just out there to help people, whether it is in the form of meals, whether it is in the form of arranging for, you know, the medicines or anything like that. So I think that's a very positive statement to say that there is hope at the end of the tunnel, and hopefully we all will get out of it. You know, there's something that most of the people are grappling with right now, and that is the fear. You know, even if I don't have, you know, COVID today, but what if I get it? Or what if my children get it? Or what if my family gets it? So the fear of catching the virus, the anxious, you know, the anxiety that we feel about catching the virus or transmitting it to a loved one. So how does one manage that fear and that anxiety, which I'm sure is impacting a lot of people's mental health right now?
So Shivani, very good question. I would say that, you know, fear is there in all of us in many forms, and not just with the COVID around, or not with the current crisis which is there. Hmm. We've always thought of certain things. What if I get cancer? What if I fall and I get a fracture? What if I get a chronic ailment? What if I land up with diabetes? All right. In the same way, this fear is catching on to us. So we need to see that there is something which is known as a healthy fear, and something which is unhealthy, something which doesn't exist. I am imagining that that is going to happen. Let's stop imagining the negative that is going to happen to us. Let's start imagining that there is light there. There is hope there. There is something to look forward to. Let's work together in humanity and get it through, you know. And when there's unhealthy fear, you're always overwhelmed. You're talking about it all the time. So I would suggest that let's keep ourselves away from the news channels which are there all the time talking of the negatives. Yes. There are these WhatsApp groups and the stories which everybody is putting up. Yeah. Stop focusing there, right? Focus on what is present. Focus on, and let's be mindful of today. Let's work on ourselves today. Tomorrow is going to be better. So whatever you tell your mind, your mind is going to believe it. So let's tell our mind some positive stuff.
Absolutely. I think I agree with you that, you know, when there is negativity going on around us, it's a natural tendency to start thinking, you know, of the negative things that might happen. And I think one of the suggestions that you gave, that, you know, stay away from the news channels, I think that's probably the best thing that one can do today in today's times. Even you know, the newspapers, while, you know, it's good to read them, and so, you know, we find a lot of information there, but these days, again, you know, the front page and everything, obituaries, I was just reading today, they've gone into pages now. So all that, you know, makes an impact on your mental health. It does affect it. But yes, I think if we train our mind to think a little positively, you know, think about the positive things that will emerge after this pandemic, why not have hope that we will survive this? I think that's what, that kind of thinking is probably what is going to help everyone. So that's
Shivani, like last year, we all thought the same way. We did see deaths, but they were not in so many large numbers, right?
Yes.
We did have hope that it is going to open up. And we all saw that it was opening up. It was opening up, but we gave up our precautions. And that's why we land up with all this, you know. So when we talk of positivity, we're not looking at toxic positivity, that all the time you can't be positive. Yes, there will be times where you will feel some bit of turbulence within yourself. So let's not only be thinking of that. Let's focus on other areas of our growth. And let's connect with various other energies which are more, you know, happy energies within us. And we can reach somewhere with those, you know. And let's just not think of the deaths. Koi cricket match thodi hai jo cricket match ki hum wo dekh rahe hain kitne score hua hai. Hame score nahi dekhna hai deaths ka. हमें ये देखना है कि कितने हम बचे हैं, हाउ मेनी ऑफ अस आर अलाइव हैप्पी बैक टू आवर होम्स एंड एवरीबॉडी इज टुगेदर.
Absolutely. In fact, there was a WhatsApp message that someone had circulated, and it was a, you know, it was around the people who have actually, you know, gotten okay, they've recovered and come back home, and that number was amazingly high. So that's a very positive news, and I'm glad someone is sharing that also on WhatsApp. So I think if you know, people talk more about it, the people who recovered and come back, there are support groups now I'm seeing on Facebook. That you know, that are helping patients who've recovered, so where they are coming and talking to people about their own experience and, you know, counseling people that it's not as bad, you can recover and come back if it comes to, you know, like that. So yeah, absolutely. You know, Dr. Roma, specifically for people dealing with grief, you know, people who have unfortunately lost a loved one to this pandemic, how do they cope with it? It is, you know, very devastating for sure to lose someone like this, and most of the people, you know, feel helpless. What's your advice for them?
I agree with that. You know, this is a helpless situation. It is a shock for all of us when you lose a loved one, and that too suddenly. If I leave pandemic for a moment and see of any deaths which are happening with accidents, or sudden deaths happening because of natural disasters, those are also shocks for us. So this is a similar kind of a shock, although we knew that so and so has COVID, and you know, we did see that person for a bit, but there's been no closure. So when there is this kind of a death, there is no closure in that.
Yes,
I would say it's all right to grieve, and everybody grieves differently. There is no same pattern for grieving. So please grieve. If you want to cry, please cry, right? But don't judge a person by saying, okay, now you need to move on. No. Mm. Till the time you're not ready for it, you can continue to work on yourself. But don't feel isolated. And connect to a loved one with whom you can talk about it. Vent it out of your system.
Yeah.
Don't complain. Don't complain to the system, to the policies, to the lack of oxygen. Talk, vent it out of your system. And maybe what you can do is, when you start remembering a person, remember of all the good times you've had with that person.
Yeah.
You know, make a little note, and maybe you can write a letter to the person who's died for that closure that can happen for you, you know.
Yeah.
And also, it's time to hug yourself and tell yourself, yes, so-and-so is gone. I will miss that person. Yet I remember. I have good memories about that person.
That's a great suggestion. I think the you know, one of the excellent suggestions I would say that you gave is that it's okay to grieve, and you know, you don't have to keep. I mean, others do keep saying you have to move on, you have to move on. But I think when one loses someone, it's, you know, the people who are around that person also need to give time to the person to grieve. A person deserves to grieve. For someone whom they've lost. But I think the idea of expressing it and not bottling it up inside you, talking, reaching out to people, talking to, you know, some loved ones, writing a letter is a beautiful idea. And it's and actually the kind of, you know, grief that people are facing is more of the closure that you spoke about, that, you know, there is no proper closure. They couldn't do proper last rites also. So that's somewhere sticks on to people. But I think that closure, if, you know, if they can get either by writing a letter or by reaching out to people or by simply remembering the fond memories, you know, of the person who's gone, I think that would really help the audience. I think that's a great, great idea. Thank you for sharing that. Okay, now coming to people who already have mental health issues, like people who are already, you know, not, I'm not saying pandemic related, but even before the pandemic had issues like anxiety or depression, what would you suggest for them? How do they make sure that their condition doesn't get aggravated in this time? What's your advice for them?
You know, for people who already have a mental illness, they may be on treatment, they may not be on treatment. There are lots of them who are not on treatment also and yet are struggling with mental health issues. Mm-hmm. But for people who are on treatment, whether psychiatric or therapeutic, I think the families need to pitch in there. They must have already pitched in with all these people who are going through this illness. is to connect and engage in conversations with them, keep them occupied, and not let them see only the negative part of it. Because when you see too much of negative and the person is already in an illness, it's going to affect him more harshly than not. So I would say that engage in conversations, keep your mind diverted to various other activities.
Yes.
If you have to see the screen, see some shows, see some episodes, see some many other things, you know, what you always wanted to do other than the news channels. That's going to keep you happier and also keep you grounded, and also get each other in the family to do some grounding exercises. It's also time for some prayers, you know, which families can do together. You know, and from childhood, we've always learned some mantras, you know. I know I was always taught the Gayatri Mantra. There's somebody who's probably knows the guy, you know, the Hanuman Chalisa and so forth. There are so many. Each religion, each thought, each system tells you about those mantras. Just recite them in the morning. You'll feel far better, more grounded, more calmer. We have to find techniques to calm ourselves.
Yes, absolutely. I think this idea of families bonding together and doing something together also gives a feeling that we're all in it together. You know, I'm not alone, and you know, I have my family with me. So whatever you know happens, we're all in it together. So I think these are some very good ideas that, and prayer definitely. I'm sure today everybody is praying, but I think collective prayers have even more power. So sit as a family and pray with your family. That's going to be one, that's going to keep you more grounded, like you said. It's going to keep you more calm, and secondly, you know, the vibes in the house are really good after that. So definitely something that that I would personally recommend, because I do that with my family. So yes. Okay, for the people, you know, now who have gone through the trauma of this virus, people who got COVID and they have now recovered. Mm-hmm. There is a tendency that you keep thinking of that harrowing experience that you had, whether you were in the hospital, or, you know, whether, especially for the people who, you know, who were hospitalized, or even if you were at home, you know, alone in a room. And some people are definitely shaken up. So what's your advice for them? How do they move on from thinking about the past and what lies maybe in the future and stay in the present? So how can they, you know, how do they build that mindfulness of staying in the present?
Thank you, Shivani. That's a wonderful question. In fact, just 2 days ago, I had written about it for a magazine where, you know, people who are out of the ICU and out of the hospital have a little syndrome that happens within themselves, because they have those flashbacks of those times when you almost feel that you're gone, or you can't breathe, or you were choking, or you've come with fungus, and you've got all that in your system and you're back home. Well, yes. I would suggest, I think, again, the mindfulness comes in there, and let's do some mindfulness exercises with the people. Listen to those harrowing experiences, but do not let them be repetitive. You know, don't shun them away. Don't tell them that, oh, you're just thinking, it's just a thought, it's over. No, listen to the person, acknowledge it. Let the person feel that, yes, that is what he or she felt. Now what is it we can do together so that we are getting better? What is it that we can do together as a family, as an extended family, so that we all feel better? And slowly, gradually get the people stop talking about it, because if you keep them occupied with other things, the fear is not going to come back, or those harsh memories are not going to come back. They will reduce.
Right. And what are some of the mindfulness techniques that people can do? One is, of course, doing things with your family. The other is keeping yourself occupied. What are some of the other things that people can, you know, do to help them, you know, not think about the past baggage or what's going to come for me in the future? I take a day as it is, as it comes.
We usually do those five exercises. You know, what are the five things you can see there? Let's look at, count those. Like, for example, I can see my fan, I can see my AC, I can see my light, I can see a television in my room. What are the five things that you can see? What are the four things that you can hear? You know, and all those senses get involved in those exercises. Second is also, you must hydrate yourself a lot, right? Hydrate yourself, whether it's with infused water, normal water, any kind of hydration activity. Third is doing some deep breathing exercises, you know, that also keeps you more calmer. So there are a couple of these calming music. You can listen to the calming music, you know. You have apps, you can listen to the music through those. You can get into meditation with those apps, you know. Get yourself occupied in these things which will keep you more calm.
Right.
Focus on the here and now, and not focus on what has gone or focus on what is going to be 3 months ahead. It's too uncertain for everybody, not even scientists. Nobody knows what is going to happen. So let's focus on today. If my today has gone better, I'm sure my tomorrow will go better. And again, inject ourselves with the hope, because hope is a decision that we all take for ourselves. So let's be hopeful. रात के बाद अंधेरे के बाद दिन आता है और जल्दी नहीं आएगा, थोड़े समय बाद आएगा, लेकिन आएगा. सो लेट्स फोकस ऑन दैट पार्ट.
एब्सोल्युटली. एंड आई थिंक दिस यू नो आई थिंक इट्स ऑल अबाउट मेकिंग दैट पैराडाइम शिफ्ट फ्रॉम लिविंग इन द यू नो द पास्ट. व्हाट हैपेंड टू मी, व्हाई डिड इट हैपन टू मी. लॉट ऑफ पीपल थिंक मुझे क्यों होना था, ये मेरे साथ ही क्यों हुआ, यू नो. इवन सो
आई वुड आई वुड सजेस्ट टू पीपल हु आस्क दिस, व्हाई डिड इट हैपन टू मी, आई वुड मेक देम थिंक इन अ डिफरेंट मैनर एंड सेड, व्हाट डिड दैट इवेंट डू टू यू इन योर इमोशंस, टेल मी व्हाट डिड इट मेक यू फील लाइक. लेट द पर्सन गेट इन टू सम क्रिटिकल थिंकिंग, लेट द पर्सन चेंज दैट थॉट. Did it make you feel sad? Did it make you angry? Did it make you have some shame? Did it get you some guilt? What is it that that event did to you? You know, I do not want to trivialize anybody's experiences. Those experiences, only the person knows, because that's his or her journey. So let's not trivialize that person here.
Yes.
And let the person now think about, what is it that happened to me, and what is it you, when you're listening to me, can you do with me so that I feel better and also feel that I'm wanted, I'm desired. And let's also see that the unity of the family is together. It is time to be together. The olden times have taught us something.
Yes.
No, the olden times have taught us a lot. This period of isolation, of the lockdown, of all those social distancing has taught us a lot. Let's take those lessons from this time, and then we'll be able to move on. You know, it's time that we focus on the newer energies which has entered all of us.
Absolutely. I think there's a lot that this pandemic has taught us, and one is the you know, the value of your own family, the value of being together. And like you said, there is a lot of energy, a collective energy that gets involved in dealing with something like this. And and I think it's a great idea, because you know, it's not just the pandemic. If anything bad happens, you know, the first reaction as human beings is why me, mere saath kyun aisa hua, whether it is COVID, whether it is anything else that you know happens which we don't like or which we don't want to happen to us. But I think the suggestion that you gave, the idea that you gave, that question yourself of on what kind of emotions that invokes in you, and be aware of it, that yes, it happened to me and this is how it affected me.
Also, we are somewhere having some dard hua hai, ठीक है, हमें चोट लगी है
जी,
तो हमें हीलिंग करनी है. अगर हम बार बार उस चोट को खुरेदते रहेंगे तो वो हील नहीं होगा. इट्स द सेम प्रिंसिपल विद माय इमोशंस. इफ आई कंटिन्यूअसली कीप ऑन फोकसिंग ऑन व्हाट दिस इमोशन हैज हार्म्ड मी विद टू व्हाट दिस इमोशन आई हैव लर्नड फ्रॉम माय हीलिंग, आई हैव टू लर्न टू हील माय सेल्फ.
यस, absolutely. It's like a wound, whether it is a physical wound or a mental or an emotional wound, it needs to be given time to heal. And if we keep on sort of digging it and
picking on it,
it's a very interesting experience that I'd like to share with you. When I started doing meditation, I used to get very affected that I'm not able to focus. You know, thoughts come into my mind and I just, get carried away and I'm not able to focus. I'm not able to focus on my breath. Ultimately, I wander away. Then I realized that, when those thoughts come into my mind, And if I don't engage with them, they don't stay for a long time. They go. So it's like, you know, it's like we are the ones who are actually encouraging those thoughts, you know, watering them, you know, feeding them with our worries, with our, you know, our anxiety. And that's when they stay and they don't go. And this is a personal experience. I have seen it that if, you know, a thought comes to my mind, I don't engage with it. I continue to focus. It ultimately goes. So it's just, yeah.
So all of us don't have the skill to do that also. We have to train our minds to get that skill.
It takes
and
time.
All of us, all of us are also not that good on meditation. Maybe there are other exercises that we can do, which we may be good at. And we don't have to sit in meditation for like 2 hours together. No, begin with 5 minutes, begin with 10 minutes, increase it. Yes. And also tell yourself you were able to do it.
Yes.
You know, so it's again coming back to that statement. Whatever you tell your mind will listen to it.
Yes, absolutely, absolutely. And it definitely, you know, doesn't come in one day. It is something that one needs to consistently be at. And one has to, you know, in your mind be firm that I will do it every day, whether it is 5 minutes, 7 minutes, like you're saying, but I will, you know, spend time doing it. And ultimately you learn the technique of, you know, doing it. So I think it comes with practice. Now, okay, great. You know, coming to children. Now, children have been the worst hit in this pandemic. They are stuck indoors for the last, you know, more than a year. And there is increased screen time. There is reduced social contact with friends. There are no outings. There are no visits to the park. And all this is probably leading to, you know, mood swings, temper issues, anger issues, depression in adolescence. What is your advice? How can parents help children in coping with these difficult times?
I agree with you. Children are, you know, children learn only through exploratory behavior and through experimenting with various activities. And that's what has not been there in the form that they did it in earlier times.
Right.
In earlier times, children were going outside the house for a couple hours to school, then come back and maybe go to your tuitions or to your sport activities. And parents, if one parent is working, will go out of the house and come back. So there was this not excessive proximity, right? The physical proximity was not there. I think what we need to now understand is even though we are all in the house, we can still create our own boundaries. And we need to create those healthy boundaries. We need to do activities, A, together as a family, B, also to learn newer skills. And not just think of, I will only study what my grade 8 or 10 or 12 is doing. I don't have to do that. Let's pick on some newer skills. We have the screen. Let's use the screen more positively where I can learn some things. For example, at my age, at my I am also trying to engage in various of these learning things. And I'm usually questioned, why you, Dr. Kumar? Why are you here? And I would always say, I want to be with the younger generation. I want to learn some things from them. Maybe I can also share and I'm going to learn. So I am also keeping my cognitive area stimulated. Also, you know, I'm productively using my time. So that's what parents and children need to do together. Some things can be done together in the house and some things the children can do themselves. So there are lots of children who are doing online yoga, or some of them have started teaching yoga to other younger kids also. You know, I have so many of those teenagers who are doing that. So many of these teenagers are also experimenting with the scientific experiments and they are doing those things. They've started blogging. They started writing things, you know. My own granddaughter, who is in grade 12, had so much of energy to do all these things that she's become like a, you know, fashion journalist over there, and she's doing that. So something, you know, it's not just a plan A, ke padhai hi karni hai. You must have plan B, C, D, E, and figure out what you can do more things. So that's how you engage in more critical thinking activities. Also, as parents, let's stop negating our children. Let's stop comparing our children to the other families. We have no idea what that family is all about. We are imagining.
Absolutely.
Because what the behavior of the child in front of a stranger is versus what the behavior is in the house is completely different for all adults also.
Absolutely.
So let's stop negating them. Don't trivialize the children. If there is something that the child is sad about and is saying, yes, I miss my friends. Yes, acknowledge he's missing his friends.
Yeah.
What is it that you as a parent can do so that the child is able to engage in the friends, you know? For example, what we do in our condominium is we'll stand like 10 feet apart from my room to the elevator. We'll be standing and we'll be talking to each other. We can do that.
Yes.
Right? There is distance, but I'm connecting. At least I'm feeling there is another human being and I'm talking.
Yes.
Let's do some things like this so that you can engage in conversations and some routine, which is very important.
Yes, absolutely.
I think adults also have forgotten that routine. So we are actually coming back, but we are adaptable. So we are coming back. So let's do some routine, some structure. Structure actually helps all of us to be grounded.
Yes, yes. I think that's a great idea.
Have some control over your sleep routine. अब इतना भी टीवी देखने की जरूरत नहीं है कि हमारा स्लीप ही खत्म हो जाए सो लेट्स गेट ऑन टू दोज लिटिल बिट ऑफ रूटीन्स एंड यू विल फील मच मोर इन कंट्रोल ऑफ योरसेल्फ इट्स टाइम टू लर्न हाउ टू रेगुलेट आवर ओन इमोशंस आल्सो
एब्सोल्युटली आई थिंक दिस आइडिया ऑफ गेटिंग इनटू रूटीन्स बोथ फॉर चिल्ड्रन एंड फॉर एडल्ट्स आई थिंक इज वेरी वेरी क्रिटिकल एट दिस टाइम बिकॉज व्हाट चिल्ड्रन आर एक्चुअली मिसिंग इज द रूटीन दैट दे हैड अर्लियर which involved some amount of a social contact outside as well. And I think if a similar, I mean, it can't be a similar routine, but at least have a routine, you know, wherein they are attending their classes, they are, you know, even meeting each other virtually. A lot of youngsters are doing it. A lot of children are, little children are doing play dates over Zoom and all of that. So I think this pandemic, I would say, look at it, you know, the other side, parents are getting to spend a lot of time with their children and actually getting to know the child much better, you know, the strengths of the child. And I think the children are also feeling, my parents are spending so much time, if they're able to spend, that is, in today's time.
But there will be times where we get into arguments and disagreements. Don't worry. We used to always get into arguments and disagreements even when COVID wasn't there.
Yes, yes.
So absolutely. Don't blame the COVID for these arguments and disagreements. Create boundaries.
Right. Absolutely. You know, Dr. Roma, for the children, you know, specifically who are dealing with grief again, you know, they hear of, they're experiencing loss of loved ones, grandparents, uncles, aunts, even parents, and every, you know, other day they hear that someone known to them, some uncle or some auntie, is in the hospital and is critical. And all this naturally makes them very fearful. So what should parents do in such a situation? How can they help the child in dealing with this anxiety and fear?
As an adult, first I have to be in control of my emotion to be able to help anyone else. So if I have control over my own emotion and if I am in a better place, only then I can help my child. Do not shun that fear away in the child. There is fear in you. There is fear in the child. Tell the child the truth. Depends on the age, but you don't have to tell the entire truth, but you have to tell the truth.
Right?
If the child is grieving or is asking you questions, do not answer those questions. Please answer those questions. You may not go at length about them, but answer those questions. If the child is saying, am I going to lose my nanny? So just say, let's pray together. Even if she's there or God takes her away, in whatever way, let's pray for her that she's happier in whichever place she is. Right?
Yeah.
Let's connect with the child and not keep on increasing the level of the fear. Right?
Yeah.
When you start accepting it, it gets better. I am currently, you know, talking to those children who have lost almost everyone in their families, including their grandparents, including both their parents. Now, as a therapist, also, I have compassion fatigue. You know, I also go through issues where I am dealing with these children and there's so much of loss and grief. But I will still connect with them and give them those answers which they are looking for. There is loss. They are feeling isolated, abandoned. No one is there. And yet you are there listening to them. So never tell lies to the child. Let them grieve. If the child is crying, let the child cry. In fact, just a couple of days back, I got a call from a grade 10 child who realized that the grandparent has gone on ventilator, and she was texting me in the middle of the night, I want to talk to you now. So I will create my boundary. I will say, I am there. I will listen to you. I will chat with you, but I can't talk right now. That means I'm there. I'm listening. I'm connecting and letting the child feel better. So right. I think we have to engage and talk to children and let them grieve.
Yes, I think their grief also needs to come out. It can't be bottled up inside. So they do need someone, to talk to, whether it is a counselor or somebody at home. But definitely something that parents should not probably ignore. Talk to your children as much as possible. The first thing that, one needs to do when one gets COVID positive is quarantine. Now, you have no access to physical human contact. You're alone for most of the time. If you're lucky and if you're at home, you're still alone. But if you're in the hospital, you're completely on your own. There is nobody allowed to visit you also and all of that. So you're basically dealing with this on your own. So what impact does isolation have on people, and how can they deal with this feeling of being isolated? Because you do need a strong mental frame to come out of the illness as well. So how do they do that?
So most of them have excessive anxiety and they are panicking. Some of them have access to televisions, so they keep themselves occupied. Some of them have access to their mobile phones, so they keep themselves occupied. But the initial time is that they are resting. Resting is very important when you are in quarantine. So resting and hydrating are these two things which are most important for you. I think that's what we need to focus on and not just focus on what it's doing to me. Praying at the time when you are in the hospital. Yes, I'm missing my loved ones, but every place allows you to connect to your family member, even through the doctor. So the doctor who's treating you will definitely get your message to your family member or your caretaker, and they will help you connect with them once a day. So that's also happening. That's also possible. If you have your phone, you can video chat with your family. So yes, there is isolation because that is the need of the hour. Because I have contacted COVID, I shouldn't want to give this COVID to other people. That is why I'm quarantining. So that is where I need to cognitively tell myself and accept it that this has happened or chala jayega. And the moment you start giving yourself these messages that it is going to go away, I am healing, it has to take time, it will go away, I'm on medication, I'm in the best place. Believe me, most of the things are controlled by our minds. So we give those messages to our minds, minds start behaving differently.
Absolutely. It's the self conversation that probably is going to help because there's nobody else to converse. So training your mind to talk to you, to yourself. There's a question that's come from audience. Any tips to deal with the being stuck in lockdown in a different city away from family?
Very tough. I've had my own son who was stuck up last year in a different country, and his wife was here and we were all stuck up, and that was a different time where we didn't know what was happening. Yes, there's a lot of stress that time. Whatever way that you can connect to that person, please make that connection possible. Whether it's a video, whether it's a call, whether it's a WhatsApp call or whatever call, connect to the person. That's the only thing that is possible. Keep each other looped into the fact that you are taking care of yourself. You're probably within the house and you are in another country or in another city, but you can also exercise within the room without going outside the room to do anything. Yes. Get into yoga, get into some exercise, play a game, or watch a series together, So that is something that you can do together. Yes, you're stuck up. Yes, you miss each other, but times will be there where you will be together. The lockdown is not permanently there. And get the person to connect with extended family members also.
Yes. Absolutely.
You can make con calls. I mean, we have done con calls and we have come on Zoom meetings with our extended families, and that's been a practice now. So yes, we can all connect and we can talk to each other.
Absolutely.
We miss. Give them a virtual hug. When I miss you, I'm giving you a virtual hug.
Yes, absolutely. And I think that's the best that we can do in today's times. We can't move out, but thanks for technology. Thank God for technology that at least we're able to see our loved ones. So
what is in my control, I will do that. What is not in my control, I can't fight over it.
Absolutely. That is the crux of the whole thing. Don't bother yourself. You're stuck in a different city. Well, you have to, you know, you have to stay there till the time the lockdown doesn't get lifted. But that doesn't stop you from getting connected with your family members. You know, it's a routine that even my family follows, our extended family. On the weekends, we get together, play a housey and, you know, chit chat, some way to keep in touch. Of course, we miss each other. You know, meeting physically is different, but this is probably the best that we can do. So I think when you tell yourself that this is, you know, at least we're able to see each other every weekend, and that puts a lot of, you know, mental ease on your brain.
And so, also the inner strength comes from there, you know, the inner strength. And also this time to question yourself, what is it that keeps me happy? You know, what are the things that keep me happy? Take a paper and pencil and put down those little pointers, you know, have some gratitude. I am there. I'm able to connect. Let's have gratitude.
Absolutely.
That these are the things that are possible. Let's have that gratitude. It'll make me feel much better. Get onto your chai, which makes you feel happy. You know, do things that make you feel happy.
Yes, absolutely. I think it's a great idea to write on a piece of paper and actually do those things which make you happy in this, whatever you can do.
Small things.
Yes, of course. You know, like I'm a person who loves to shop, but now with the lockdown, I can't go out and shop. So I shop online. At least it gives me some happiness.
So, absolutely. You know,
one has to find ways to deal with it, right?
And also you can just get ready, wear your makeup and just make yourself feel peppier. And it's good. It's good. And if somebody questions you, why are you wearing makeup? My choice.
Yes.
I am answerable to myself.
Yes, absolutely. And it also expires after some time. So please use your makeup, girls, whoever has it. Okay, great. You know, there is one more question that has come to us from the audience. This person says that there has been a lot of work pressure these days in my company and they're firing people. Now, again, something that a lot of people must be going through. And I get panic attacks at night, sometimes in the fear of losing my job. That if I lose a job in this time, I won't even get a new one. So how do you suggest I deal with this situation?
So I know that what I understand is that you are getting messages of people losing jobs. You know of people who have lost the job. But I'm also imagining a fear which is not existing. I'm letting my brain believe that I'm going to lose my job. Do not give yourself these messages, because your brain will believe it and we will do things which will make us go through these issues. You know, actually, brain is very powerful. Mind is very powerful. Whatever you start thinking of, and if you consistently, repetitively tell yourself that it's going to happen, it will happen. So focus on things. Yes, there is work pressure. Work timings have become different. For people like us, we were never doing teletherapy. We were trained to do face-to-face counseling. We have trained ourselves without any outside help. We made mistakes. We did it. I would have hours to tell myself that, okay, this is the time I will end my work. There is no hours that we are following. If somebody says Sunday, I'm like, every day is like this only. So what happens if it's a Sunday? So when I'm counseling a family from three different parts of the world, I will have to be probably awake in some time of the night. So I'm allowing myself. So, you know, this is also a time where you have to see what you can do, what your strengths are, how much you can stretch yourself. Do not overstretch. There is no competition there. There is no comparison.
Right.
Or if there is something which is going to happen, it might happen, but there's always hope. Let's focus on hope.
Sure. Absolutely. I think that's a very, very practical suggestion. you know, it's about not thinking that if, you know, it might go wrong. It might go wrong, but like you said, the mind is very powerful. And if I start thinking that ab to aisa hoga hi, to ultimately it'll make me do things ki ultimately aisa ho hi jayega.
So hum subah uthte hain na, kabhi kabhi kehte hain aaj to kuch locha hone wala hai, kuch to gadbad hone wala hai, aur and by the end nahi kuch hua to hum connect kar denge.
Very right, very true. Okay, there's a concern that has come from a parent that my kid has started to keep quiet a lot during her online sessions. She was never like this. I'm not able to understand what has changed in her. I've tried talking to her, but she gets irritated when I bring this up. She's just 12 years old. I don't know what to do.
I understand, Mr. Kapoor, that there's a question which you say that she's keeping quiet during online classes. It's difficult to connect online. Virtually, it's actually very difficult. And it becomes very monotonous. Yes. Right? So if Shivani was not engaging in conversation with me, I would give up after a while because monologue is very difficult, right? So, you know, if the classroom is engaging her with some questioning or some engaging in some conversation, I'm sure she's not going to be quiet. It's yeah. All right. She's going through a phase. Do not ask her why you are quiet.
Yes.
Let's ask her differently, like I said earlier. What is it that happens when you are on the online class? And what is it happening inside you? Is it boring the classroom? What is happening? Let's question. Let's sit down and talk instead of finding a fault in her or trying to find out, because children are not good at giving their emotional experience out, because as a culture, we've never allowed our emotional experiences to be out.
Yes. You know?
So let's engage in conversation. Let's do some activities together. Let's do some coloring. Let's engage her in some baking activity. I'm just giving you various techniques. You can do many things together at home.
Sure.
And not just let her feel that online mein chup kyun hai. Chup hai to koi baat nahi. Hum log kitne office mein baithte hain, official meetings mein chup baithte hain kyunki bore ho gaye hain usi cheez se. It's all right.
Right. Absolutely. We also feel bored at times, and you know, when we switch off the camera and we put ourselves on mute, it's okay. But when the child does it, everyone has a problem.
Yes,
I think it's okay to let them be sometimes. It's they're not used to sitting in front of a screen and going, you know, going on and on for 4-5 hours. And it's okay if they, you know, my daughter sometimes tell me I don't want to attend this class. I'm okay with it. You know, even jab physical school mein jate the, to pura din chutti lete the beech mein. You know, if they someday that had to happen. Now it's about missing one or two classes. So I think as a parent, we also should be flexible. Sometimes we also feel, you know, we don't feel like attending meetings of our office, but we have to. And sometimes, you know, we also avoid those meetings. So and they're just little children. So I think...
And it's a tough time for them.
It's a tough time.
Nobody, I mean, none of us have seen these harsh times, you know. People like me, I've seen the 1971 war and how as a kid we were and what we used to do. We used to sit in our trenches and do so many things because I come from an army background. I've seen those 1984 riots. Where have our children seen adverse situations? They haven't been exposed to adversities.
Yes.
So this is an adversity from where they're going to bounce back with resilience and agility only with the experiences we give them now. And I'm very sure that this young generation is going to bounce back very well because they've seen really harsh times.
Yes, absolutely. Very challenging times, which is challenging their mental, physical, emotional, every aspect. So I think that's the positive way to look at it. There's a question that has come from a teenager that I end up, you know, I'm in a lot of stress because of what's happening around me and I end up doing binge eating. You know, I take solace in food and that's now affecting my health. So what do I do? How do I make myself pull away from that food that gives me comfort in a stressful situation?
Khana kisko nahi acha lagta, sabko acha lagta. Hum sab lockdown mein itna khaye hai, sabne khaya hai. But we need to question ourselves. What are the other things that give me solace and happiness apart from food? So I will have to create a balance in myself. I am not saying stop yourself from eating. But what I'm saying is stop yourself from eating way too much. In fact, you know, explore yourself. what are the things that give you solace other than eating? Or what are the times that you sit down to eat and that gives you solace? Is it right. while watching television? Is it while watching shows? What is it that gives you, you know, that eating and that solace together? Look at other things that will give you happiness and solace minus the eating. And don't shame attack yourself. Do not feel guilty. It has happened. We have all gone through hard times right now. And if it has happened, it will go away with your effort. It's like a bank account. The more you put in, the more you're saving, you'll have to debit it out. So we'll have to do more activities to debit it out. Nothing wrong in it. Just explore yourself. You will find some ways.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Very, very, very practical suggestion again, Dr. Roma. There is someone in the audience who's asking, will you please tell some mindful techniques in practical use? How can we motivate our staff, office staff? How do we give them positive affirmation? Mr. Madan Srikant is asking this question.
Okay. So mindfulness techniques is hum ikathe baithkar in the office staff. We all can do some calming exercise together. We can do some visualization exercise together. We can, you know, put on some music together. Even on the internet, we can put the music on together. Even if we are doing in a meeting, there's background music, which is a soft music, and you can still talk. That's a calming technique. Mindfulness is the 5-4-3-2-1 technique, which is very, very commonly being used these days. Five things that you can see, four you can hear, and three that you can feel, and two you can, you know, all the senses have to be used, and that is what is going to be good. So you can use many of those techniques and find ways to play a game together, you know. So that they remain motivated and they are happier connecting with the leader. So that's also good.
Yeah, I think one thing that has worked for one of my clients is that they meet every day, and they meet for a team huddle that they do. And but the first 20 minutes is nothing related to work.
Yeah,
it's nothing related to work. It is just chit-chatting, you know, just like the way you come to office in the morning, you meet your colleagues and you're just asking, you know, kaisa chal raha and all of that, and some, you know, some fun activity. In the sense, it doesn't have to be a game or anything, but anything like a, you know, a small anecdote or a WhatsApp forward that somebody wants to share. The idea is to lighten the mood and feel that, okay, this is, we're all together again.
We at the Emotionally, our co-founders and partners, we are together in the morning from March 20th of 2020. Every day we are together for 1 hour. And we would share things or pictures. We just click pictures outside. We saw this bird or we see this nice clouds and we are talking about it. And then we are talking of what work we need to do. So it's like engaging in different conversation apart from work so that you feel more motivated to talk about other things.
Absolutely. And I think the more you connect with your people, the more, you know, it's going to be easy to give them this positive affirmation that you're talking about, because you are, you know, connecting with them on a daily basis. It's like, you know, what's going on with them. And this is what I advise, you know, to a lot of my HR clients, you know, people who are working as HR people, that just build, connect with your people in these times. Right now, their only expectation is to, you know, have a good connect with you, you know, understand their concerns, what they're going through, and try and solve whatever you can, whatever is within your reach. So that's there. Okay, I think there are many, many questions that have come, but we'll have time for a couple of more questions. So there is one question that I have, you know, lost my best friend last month, and I'm not able to move on and realize the fact that she's no more with me. So how do I move on?
Okay. Moving on isn't easy for everybody, right? We have been talking about those little, you know, phrases that time is the best healer, and that is true. I know that you're missing your friend. You're missing the good times. You're missing that conversations that you used to have. You're missing that who will you share things with now, right? But again, being mindful that she's no longer there, right? I need to have a closure. And when you have a closure, you will write something down to her. Maybe a couple of letters you can write to her and express that and vent it out of your system, right? Mm-hmm. And give yourself a time of the day that between 4 to 4:30, I'm allowed to miss her. But the rest of the time, I will work on other things so that I don't hamper my own activities, because I'm sure my friend is not going to like it that I'm hampering my own daily activities, right? I'm allowed to think about her, but I'm not allowed to overthink about her.
Right.
Right. A lot of us are putting those messages of losing our friends or our relatives or somebody or the other on the social media. If that gives you solace, please do that. Pray for her wherever she is, that she's going to be happier. So that's the way healing will happen. And there will be a time that slowly, slowly, gradually, you will feel that you're getting better. Healing is taking place. So moving on is a very tough statement. You know, everybody takes their own time. And some of us have grieved for way too long, but that's also unhealthy. So let's give ourselves some time and you will feel better.
Sure. Thank you. Thank you for that. There's another question that in these times, how do we maintain sanity in personal relationships, be it with parents, spouse, or children?
Because पहले भी तो प्रॉब्लम होती थी, अभी भी होगी. सो अभी ज्यादा होगी क्योंकि हम बहुत ज्यादा इकट्ठे रह रहे हैं. स्पाउसेस को भी आदत नहीं थी इतना इकट्ठा रहने की. सो थोड़ी सी बाउंड्री क्रिएट करें. Create some space for yourself. This is my safe space. This is something that I will want to do for myself now, right? And if I do land up into an argument, don't have a battle there. It's not a battleground. Stop attacking each other. These are tough times. Forgive each other. We have to learn to forgive each other and not sleep over those arguments. Not have hatred towards each other. Not have that shaming all the time and making you feel that you are good for nothing, right? We make mistakes,
right? Right. Absolutely.
So we will make those, and we're staying to wait too much together. So give yourself some space and role allocation. Most important, allocate some roles for each other. That this is something that you will do, and this is something that I will do. And supposing I'm unable to do, I don't feel like doing it, leave it. Nothing's going to happen. If the help is not there in the house, and if you've not cleaned your room one day, nothing will happen. It's all right. Focus on something else so that you're able to gain back that strength in yourself.
Absolutely. The point that you made about creating space, I think why people are also facing issues is because somewhere that personal space has been invaded. The inability to go out or have my own personal time. But I think again it depends on you. If you can make that demarcation even within the house, have 30 minutes or 45 minutes or 1 hour to yourself completely, and everybody else.
That's what we do in the house.
Yes.
अच्छा और नई जगह मिल रही है. मेरे क्लाइंट्स क्या करते हैं, जगह नहीं है घर में, बात करनी है आपसे, they'll go to their car and sit down in the car and talk.
Yes.
Already I've created space.
Yes.
There's nothing wrong in it.
Absolutely. There's nothing wrong in it. Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely right. Great. I think, we can continue, but there is a time constraint, and I'm sure you have a lot of time pressure today because, the time is such that many people would be wanting your support. But it's been a wonderful conversation. For our audience here, just one thing that I'd like to mention, that in case you'd like to have, a personalized counseling, advice or a session with Dr. Roma, please contact on this number that has been given in the chat, and we'll fix it up depending on Dr. Roma's schedule. Dr. Roma, it was really great talking to you. It was one of probably the best sessions that I've had personally, because I really, it's something that's put me to a lot of ease today with all your practical suggestions and tips to, wade through these tough times. And I'm sure our audience also agrees. And I can see the comments here. I love this session, and people are saying all sorts of things. So my deepest gratitude to you for coming here today and talking to us and to the audience. really, you know, it's been of immense help to a lot of people who are struggling with these things at these times. So very, very grateful. Thank you for the session. And we look forward to seeing you again soon on our show.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. And let's hope all of us remain safe and all of us remain happier. And let's ignite hope in all of us.
Absolutely. Thank you. Thank you to the audience. All right. I hope you all stay safe. Well, please stay indoors. Don't step out. And we're all together in this. I think that's what my biggest takeaway is from this session. We're all in it together. Thank you and have a great weekend ahead, everyone.
Thank you.